If you don't do mananam on the same day, then so much is lost. Next day, half of it is gone. Next day, almost everything is gone. In a week, nothing remains except for one or two things like Nachiketa and Yama. That is all Kathopanishad. That's what will remain at the end. So because you have done some mananam, it's good. And I hope you have enjoyed doing the mananam. It's not that it should not be treated as a burden. I said yesterday, we should live effortlessly. Whatever happens, we should be effortless in our attitude. Whatever happens, as it comes, we take it in our stride and are happy with it. That should be the idea. Any knowledge survives on these three. Shravanam first, mananam second, and nididhyasanam third. And nididhyasana means practically putting into your life and seeing whether it works or not. That's why the Vedanta has many things. One is, of course, all the shruti that is coming. Next is yukti. You have to also do logical, rational. What is the logic behind Kathopanishad? Is this really true? Does it really happen when we choose pleasant over the good? Is it that we get temporary pleasures and we become happy, but even ultimately we suffer? Are these principles true or not? You have to apply it in your own life. Very true it is. Suppose you get one itch. Some people who have some skin rashes or disease, they start itching. And how long they keep itching? They keep itching because in this itching there is great sukha. The blood is coming. How much you are scratching yourself? But in that scratching, the sukha, who can compare the sukha of scratching oneself? You see dogs and all the time they are scratching. Blood will come out of their skin, so much they scratch. Till somebody comes and tells, "Yo, what you are doing, don't scratch, control. It will harm you more than it will help you." So that is how these temporary pleasures are, and the permanent ones you have to wait for the wound to heal. If you scratch it, then it will get spoiled. So like that, in small, small things to the biggest things of your life, the decisions that you make, you must see how Shreya and Preya is actually very practically applicable principles. Whenever you took a Prayo Marga for Yoga Kshema Drunite, always there at the end you have only suffered. These simple principles are there. In our own life, we have to apply these, test them in the laboratory of our lives and see for ourselves whether this is true or not. So that is the idea of this Nididhyasana part of the Shibira. Shravana, now the last phase of the Shibira is going on. 10 days if you divide. This last phase is all about Nididhyasana. Because what I am going to be talking about in Kathopanishad now, it's all philosophical. The main part, what has to be done in one's life, all that has been explained already in Kathopanishad. What all has been explained? That whatever the temptations are coming in life, we have to avoid them and keep our focus on knowing the truth. That is the first chapter. Second chapter is what about how to start on this path of spirituality, choose the good, choose the right over the pleasant and easy. And that is what is going to lead you ultimately to the truth. And how is this truth? This truth is very, very subtle. It cannot be just received. You can't read it in a book and understand it. You can't hear a lecture and understand it. Or you can't watch a movie on Kathopanishad and understand it. It's not as straight as that. It has to be experienced. Now, how do I experience this great truth? It has to be experienced only by your mind. How? One, yachet vang manasi, pragyastat yachet jnanaatmani, then ultimately, shantaatmani. So, jnanaatmani, mahatiatmani, shantaatmani, these are the processes of how vang manasi, from the senses and indriyas, which are running outside, bahirangava, paranchikhani, vatrunat swayambhu, tasmat paran pashyati na antaratma. So all that indriyas have to be put into the mind, means withdrawn. That is what is pratyahara, we call it in the yoga. Withdrawing the senses and which are running behind sense objects and limited pleasures, you withdraw it into the mind. Let mind observe your where it is going. So you don't live by instincts of ahara, nidra, bhaya, maithuna anymore. You're living it with greater consciousness of why we are doing anything. And from there you further use your buddhi, that is your own personal atman, jnana atmani they call it, the intelligence that God has given you. Withdraw it into that. And then, since your own buddhi may also fluctuate based on the time, place and situations, so what you do, you merge this buddhi into the higher cosmic buddhi, the intelligence of God. Surrender your buddhi to God's buddhi. And then follow what God is telling from inside. That becomes the Mahati Atmani. And finally, even in that, there is a thinking aspect. Oh, I have to do this or not do this. Is this that? Is it this? From there, you go into the Shanta Atmani, where there is no disturbance whatsoever. What is Shanta Atmani's idea? Shanta Atmani is witness. It witnesses whatever is coming and going. Mahati Atmani thinks in a complete or in a collective way. And Jnana Atmani thinks in an individual way. So simple example, Jnana Atmani is, I want to eat this, I don't want to eat that. In a home, you are there at home, and you will tell, I want to eat this only today, and nanage dosane beku, nan bere yavudu tinnalla anta neevu hata maadthiri. You will throw tantrums, I will eat only dosa, I don't want to eat whatever upma. Then what will happen, there are 5-6 people at home, there is no time for the mother to prepare dosas for everybody, so she has made upma today, she is busy. Then what happens, if you merge this mind into Mahati Atmani, you will think, is this demand correct on this day? Mother is very busy. Should I demand for dosa or shall we adjust with upma? Then what is happening? Collective thinking is coming. For the sake of everyone in the family, you adjust. For the sake of everyone in the society, you adjust. For the sake of everyone in the country, you adjust. For the sake of everyone in the world, you adjust. That is Mahati Atmani. A social or a collective consciousness. This is individual consciousness. It thinks only for itself. Then the Mahati Atmani thinks collectively. What is good for everyone? Let us do that. And then finally, when you merge it into Shanta Atmani, there is no thinking there. You just accept things as they come under the great divine master plan. You realize that you are just a witness as the Atman and everything else is just the actions that are happening as a part of the nature and the world. So you realize that and you become absolutely peaceful. That is the idea of this merging of Indriya into mind, into Jnanatmani, into Mahati Atmani and Shantatmani. At individual Jnanatmani, you think of yourself, what is good, bad for you. In Mahati Atmani, you think of what is good and bad, what is the thing that will help everyone at this point in time. And in Jnana Atmani, you don't even think. You have already merged your mind in God. Where is your mind to think anything? Therefore, that you reach a stage of absolute peace. As and when whatever comes, you take it in your stride and you are happy. You are not disturbed by that. So that is so practical. Now you think for yourself, are these principles really applicable? Can we apply it in today's times and situations? Does this help us in any way? Does it make it better for us? All these questions you have to put to yourself. Then only you will know that these principles of Upanishads are so valid. And therefore I say, reading Upanishad is never a loss. It was valid 10,000 years ago, it is valid today, and it will be valid 10,000 years from now. The Upanishadic principles and truths. Therefore, Upanishadic study is never a loss. Every other study is a loss. After some time, your memory will fade and that study is of no use to you or the technology will change. Upanishad Siddhantas are for everyone. At all times, they are valid. Take any simple Siddhantas and you will know for yourself that it is possible. See, why it's easy for children to believe? Why it is so easy for children to do things which elders find it difficult to do, especially when it comes to faith and surrender and conviction? And why is it so easy in that? So I wanted to share a story with you. It seems it so happened that in one village, two brothers were playing. One was a younger fellow. He was only 6-8 years old. Another fellow was an older fellow, were 12-14 years old. So as they were playing, their ball fell into the well. And so happened that the elder fellow wanted to pick up the ball. And as he wanted to go there and pick the ball up, he slipped and fell in the well. Now everybody got panicked. What do we do? He's already fallen inside. So the younger fellow went there with a rope and put the rope down and said, "You catch this rope, I will pull you out." And the older fellow caught the rope and this younger fellow tried everything and pulled him out finally of the well. After having done that, they thought, should we tell this to our parents or not? Because now both are safe. But if we tell this to parents, even though they have come out of the well, they will see the hell now at home. So these children thought, let us not tell this to anybody. But you see, there are friends in the vicinity. You think these friends will keep quiet when they have an opportunity to get these fellows beaten up by their parents? You think they will lose the opportunity? Let us complain. Can't keep in our stomach. So some of them, the gossip gang, went there to the village and spread this. You know what? The elder fellow had fallen down. Then what happened? Then this younger fellow pulled him out. What are you taking? Nobody believed them. Why they didn't believe? Because how can a 5-year-old fellow pull a 12-year-old fellow out of the well? Simply don't come and gossip, and they rejected it. So all these friends are very, very sad. They said, we tried to tell the truth that this has happened, but nobody in the village is believing us. They say, how can a 5-year-old pull out a 12-year-old fellow from the well? Not possible. Simply don't gossip here. Go and do your work. People sent them away. Then finally, these children went and told the parents also. The parents were suspicious because they saw the wet clothes and other things. But they were not able to believe that these children and other people are telling the truth. So they went to a very great guru who was there in the village. Mostly every village had a small temple where some sannyasi or guru was established, whose only job was to guide people correctly. So they went to him and said, these children are telling that the older fellow had fallen in the well and the younger fellow has pulled him out. Do you think it is true? Because how can it be possible? And the wise old Guruji told, I think it is truth that this older fellow had fallen and the younger fellow had pulled him out. Huh? Is it so? Everybody got scared. How is it possible at all? He said, because the younger fellow did not know that it is impossible, so he made it. He did not have the buddhi of the older fellows that how can I pull out somebody bigger than me in size. He didn't know these do's and don'ts and possibilities and impossibilities in life. He just went out, anything falls in the well, we have to pull it out. So he went ahead and pulled him out. Because the younger fellow was not taught by the society that this is not possible, so he went ahead and did. And it became possible. That is why I say, in the word impossible, if you split it, it becomes I am possible. I as an I am possible. So if you read it, I am possible. So everything is possible if you believe it's possible. Everything is a game of mind. This whole prapancha is the game of mind. That is why mano moolam idam jagat, I keep saying. All this, what you see, understand, experience is just the game of mind. If mind is convinced and mind is strong, nobody can do anything for them. If mind is not convinced, mind is weak, mind is shallow, nobody can help such a person. Nobody. A 5-year-old or 6-year-old can pull out a 12-year-old from the well because his mind does not know that it is not possible. His mind thinks anything is possible as a child's mind. He has not been taught by the society, oh, this is not possible, that is not possible. Therefore, the faith in the children and their conviction is far, far, far strong. Whereas older people have already been taught. Whether they have tried or not, they have been told, don't even try, this doesn't work. This is no point. I believe in somewhere in early 1900, that time the scientific discoveries and inventions were happening at a very fast pace. New things were coming out, telephone coming out, electricity, then radio, and then all new age communication, everything one by one, amazing things. People were starting to fly, and they were all amazing discoveries and inventions. At some point of time, I believe the UK, Europe, those people controlled almost the whole world at that point in time because of colonialism. And there is a scientific council, which was a very prestigious committee to be a part of. And they would only allow the best of the brains from around the world, and most of it will be Europeans only. There, somebody declared, all that which had to be discovered and invented has been done. There is nothing more to be invented. This was the declaration made by one of the committee members in that scientific committee in early 1900s that, all that which man can ever discover and invent, it has been done. There is nothing more to be discovered, he declared. Look at him and look at what is the world today. That time there was no internet, there were no computers. Such kind of biotechnology did not exist. The kind of space research that is going on did not exist. And so many other things, so many amazing things that have happened in the last 100 years could not have been predicted at all, that world could be like this. And that is how human mind is. It thinks it's very, very limited. Whereas it is very unlimited. Mind's capacity is infinite. How, when mind becomes merged in the infinity, the divinity, the mind's capacity becomes infinite. Its intelligence, its power, its capabilities, everything multiplies to infinite times. But we think we are limited beings. The bowl fish thinks what? That's all is the world. It's limited. The moment it jumps out of the bowl and jumps into the sea, now what happens? Suddenly it sees its world has expanded to infinite. This limited existence is this idea that we are body. The unlimited existence is we are that Brahman alone. We are not less than that. The one who understands this about him, the Upanishads say, what do they say? Tato na vijugupsate. Such a person does not have to worry, does not have to hide, does not have to secure anything, does not have to save himself. It is not required for such a person. Why? He's infinite, he's ultimate, he's everything. There's nothing can be done to such a person. He's above and beyond everything. And above all, he comes under direct protection of Brahman. And therefore, Brahman decides everything for such a person whose mind has merged into Mahati Atmani and Mahati to Shanta Atmani. What will happen to me? What will happen to me? These kind of worries disappear for that person because he has merged his mind into the highest Parabrahman. And once you have merged it into Parabrahman, there is infinite potential that you have attained. So that is the whole idea of this Kathopanishad. That from the limited existence, limited beings that we think we are, to the infinitely capable, infinite potential that is ours, we should claim that. But who can do that? Nobody can do that for you. You only have to do that for yourself. By following these simple principles of Kathopanishad, one, the temptations of the world are not permanent and therefore the happiness that comes out of body, mind and senses which are temporary cannot be permanent. So don't waste your time behind that. So what should I spend my time on? Spend your time on pursuing the path of self-realization. How do I go about? Always choose the right good thing which will take you towards God over all the other things in life. Whatever keeps you closer to God and helps you take a step closer to your divine self, go for that and leave everything else. If there are obstructions and obstacles on the path, does the river ever sit down and think, oh, this ocean is so far, I have started from Himalaya, that is Bay of Bengal, on the way comes Himachal Pradesh, then comes the UP, and then comes the Bengal, and after Bihar also in between, and Bengal, and then finally I will go and merge into the ocean, not too far. And how much difficulty the river faces, have you ever noticed? So many boulders come in the way, so many mountains come in the way, towns come in the way, villages come in the way. Whoever tries to stop it, it takes another turn, either overcomes it or finds an alternate route, but keeps progressing. That is why when we go to Rishikesh and we sit by Ganges, especially the room that is allotted, it overlooks Ganges, I see not a minute Ganges is quiet. Every second it's flowing. Every second, every waking, sleeping, dreaming second, it's flowing towards the ocean. Continuously, without rest, without stopping. What an inspiration it is. Forget Ganges. Now if you are going somewhere, suppose there's a traffic jam, you get a GPS signal, or Google will tell you. What? This route is very, very high traffic, red line it will show in the map. Car, we have GPS, it shows red line. It means huge traffic jam at Makari Circle or Hebbal or wherever, whichever town you are from, the central area. Then what will this Google do? It will give you alternate routes. If you go by this route, 2 hours gone in the middle of the Bangalore traffic. So there are alternate longer routes, but possibly you will reach faster. So what do? You take alternate routes, but you don't forget where are you going. Just because you took the alternate route, you don't land up in Hyderabad. You are always in your mind, back of your mind, you always know that you're moving towards Bangalore. If there is a traffic, you'll find some routes which will take you to Bangalore only. Just because that route is full of crowd, let us go to some other place. That doesn't work. So likewise, river, it knows it has to go to the ocean. It will take all kinds of routes, but finally it will reach the ocean. Likewise, this Jnana Atmani, the individual consciousness, may find it difficult to merge itself in the divine consciousness. Obstacles will come, deha bhi mana will come. This body is the first obstacle. Then all that has been taught to you, conditioned. This is right, that is wrong, these are your people, those are not your people, this is what you should be attaining in life, that is not. All kinds of things have been stuffed into the head. What is possible, what is impossible, what is not to be done, what is to be done, has been taught and taught and taught so much that you don't realize that you have got into a maze of your own imagination. Now coming out of it is so difficult. And then you decide, forget God, let us settle down for the world. No, you should not. Come what may, uttishtata, jagrata, prapya, varan, nibodhata. That's it. Whatever it is, I have to go to Bangalore, so I will go to Bangalore only. I will go by different routes. But I shall not give up my goal, come what may. Like river does not give up its goal. That way a jivatma should never give up the goal of merging in the Paramatma. Because that is what is ultimate truth. Don't settle down for something else. I always give this example. If your mother is looking ugly, do you call a neighboring, whatever other beautiful lady as your mother? That is not the attitude. You have to stick on to your convictions, and the highest conviction of life is, I must achieve God. That's the highest conviction of life. And for that sake, anything can be done. Chajet purusham kulasyartham, ga gramasyartham kulam tyajet, gramam janapadasyartham atma arte prithvim tyajet, it says. For the sake of greater good of community, individual can be sacrificed. For the greater good of the whole village or society, family or your community can be sacrificed. For the greater good of nation, society can be sacrificed. And for God's sake, for the sake of realizing Atman, Atmarthe, Prithvim Tyajet, the world itself can be sacrificed. This is the goal. So priority, how do you prioritize? God alone is the priority, and how to reach God should be the one and the only purpose of your life. Come what may, I shall not give up the pursuit of this true path. And that is the way one should be convinced in life, and accordingly all the energy, all his efforts should be guided towards that only and nothing else. So next is, we have heard yesterday in Kathopanishad's second chapter, first valli, yade veha tadamutra yadamutra tadanviha mrityo samrityu maapnoti ya iha nana eva pashyati. That which is here alone is there, that which is there is here, and the one who sees it as different things, that person goes from death to death. That which is in this body as jivatma, manifesting as jivatma, and that which is manifesting as the whole jagat, both are not different, both are same only. And therefore, if I see that is different, this is different, they are lesser, I am greater, I am better, they are not good, all these differences and that you think or you see, such a person is going from death to death. Because death means what? Death means futility. Anything that comes to an end is over. Now there is no more use for that. Anything that dies and it is done, it's done. So it means your life has been wasted away in wrong pursuit. You have not attained Advaita Darshanam Jnanam. That which is one, the one who sees one, that is true wisdom. They don't see different. Then you may ask, how can I see one? He is a male or I'm a female, or the boy or girl, old man, young man. All these are differences in the ghatas, the bodies. The akasha inside, the space inside is one and the same. The space which we see inside the eye of a needle, and the space which is there outside. If you see, take a needle and see, one small hole will be there. It's called the eye of the needle, through which you pass a thread. Now if you put that needle in front of you, it will look like the space is so small. But truth is that that space in the needle and the space all around you, are they different spaces? Can you say the space in the eye of the needle is different from the space that exists outside that? It appears that if it has been captured in this small hole, but the truth is what? That space in the eye of the needle and the space everywhere is one and the same. The one who sees that space and not the needle, that person is not seeing things differently. That person is seeing everything as one only. So the one who sees beyond the bodies and the minds, beyond the physical appearances and mental dispositions of people. That's why I say, whenever you meet anybody, what are you actually interacting? Whom are you interacting with? You're interacting with their minds only. You're not interacting with the person completely. You're interacting with their mind. A good person, bad person, sharp person, dull person, kind person, harsh person. All these are his mind's compositions. And that mind is activated through this body. The body is behaving accordingly. He's a very rude person, so his mouth speaks rude words. Very kind person, his mouth speaks kind words. That's all it is. But who is doing? Mind is doing that. But behind the mind sits this Atman. Atmanam ratinam viddhi. He said the passenger behind is the Atman. And that Atman with the buddhi and mana and the senses is behaving in the world. If buddhi is pure, a mind is strong and senses are under control, joyful ride. But if they are not, then suffer. So whatever we see in the world, we see only these things, the person's mind, buddhi interacting with the senses and expressing itself. But beyond that is the Atman. So the moment we go little deeper and see the Atman, everybody is one. Ek Atma, Sarva Bhutantaratma, it is said. The same space is every space. There is no difference. The one who realizes that, Tatona Vijugupsate, that person alone will not be afraid of anything. Because everything is me, he will say. What should I, where is the question of yoga kshema here? No, it's not required. So preyo vrinite yoga kshema, that concept will go away. Shreyo vrinite, the highest truth. That is what will happen to you. Yamai vesha vrinite. Who will ask for the highest truth? The shreyo marga person. Why? Because he has gone beyond this yoga kshema business, this preyo marga business. This is my, I have to save this. These are my people, I have to protect them. This is my wealth, I have to preserve it. This is my body, it should be protected. All these little ideas come only for those who have not yet gone into the Shreya path. Now apply this today. So all these have to be applied. It seems in Baghdad, once a very rich man lived. And he had a daughter whom he wanted to get her married to a person who was devoted to God because he had no dearth of wealth. He was not looking for a rich fellow, richer than them. He wanted somebody who is more devoted and surrendered to Allah. Such a person should be married to my daughter. And then he searched everywhere, but he could not find a person like that. Finally, where he reached a mosque. And in the mosque, he was praying. And after the prayers were over, everybody left. But this one man shedding tears, I was sitting and singing the glories of Allah, and he was looking very poor, this young man, tatters. So this rich man went close to him and was very impressed to see that he was not asking Allah for anything. He was only saying, Allah, I love you and I'm so contented in this idea that I am in your love. That's all I want, I have no desires. So he became very happy and he said, I have to get him married to my daughter. So he proposed and this man accepted. And the daughter was also so cultured. They didn't say this poor man to come and live in their palace. The daughter said, as per the rule, I will go and live with him in his hut. Look at her devotion. So she went with just one pair of clothes on the body to his house. And they started living in the hut. One day it so happened that this man had gone to the mosque to pray. And this lady at home was cleaning the little hut, whatever they had. And she found a piece of bread hidden in a corner. And the lady got very surprised. How come there is a piece of bread here? I did not know about it. Who kept it here? Who hid it here? She kept on thinking. Anyways, when the husband came back from the prayers, she asked, I found a piece of bread lying in a corner, hidden under some clothes. Who kept it? He said, I only kept it. Why did you keep it? I was thinking, what will we eat tomorrow? Therefore, I kept a piece of bread. Just in case we don't get anything to eat tomorrow, at least we'll eat this bread. Then this lady said, oh, what a mistake I have made to marry somebody who has no faith in God. He's hiding bread for tomorrow. I thought I have married a devotee of God who is totally surrendered to God's will and he has no worry of tomorrow. And he should know that tomorrow is the, if it, God gives me to live tomorrow, he will also provide me whatever is required for my life. And he's hiding bread under the blanket. What a fate I have married a wrong person, she started lamenting. See, that is the idea of prayo hi mando yoga kshemad vrunite. Hiding things, protecting yourself, all the time worried about your own personal welfare. These are all for those who have only understood that body is all. They have never gone beyond that idea that there is something greater that exists. So if Kathopanishad you read and you still are running behind this silly things, seeing things differently, this is my body, my family, my things, and that is yours. This kind of difference is the one who is living by mrityu samrityu apnoti. They are people who have simply wasted the entire life. And they move from death to death. Every time Yama comes, ayo, this fellow is back in my class. Like the teacher, whole year he taught, exams happened, that fellow failed again. Next year when the new session started, the teacher was unaware, he walked into the class, this fellow is again in my class. What happened? I failed. Whole year you have wasted. That is what he will tell. You wasted a whole year. Because the result of the whole year should have been you passing and from getting promoted. If that did not happen at the end of the whole year, it means your whole year was a mere waste. That is what is the idea of mrityum samrityum apnoti. Because you lived a whole full life, 100 years, at the end of it, what happened? Nothing happened. You are same, in the same place, coming back to death again and again. So this is the idea of mrityo samrityum apnoti, iha nana iva pasyati. Now let us look at the next shloka, 11th shloka. Manase veda maptavyam neha nana asti kinchana mrityoh samrityum gachati ya iha nanaeva pasyati. It says, manase evedam aptavyam. Through mind only one can know this and attain this. Na iha nana asti kinchana. What? That in this place here, there is nothing called other. There is nothing called different things. This idea of oneness can be achieved only through one's own mind. And the one who does not achieve this, what happens to him? The same thing. Mrityo samrityum gachati. From one death, he goes to another death, who thinks that all are different over here. The one who sees oneness only goes beyond, otherwise he keeps going from death to death. Now you may ask, till now we heard, yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasa saha, that cannot be described in words and attained by mind, was said. Now what we are saying, with mind only you can know this. There is no other way. So seemingly contradictory, the two sentences actually are very deep in their understanding. Mind cannot achieve this. It means if mind is separate from that, mind cannot get that. Suppose I want to get this tumbler. So I have to get this tumbler. Right? In that way, if you think of Brahman, that this mind has to get that Brahman, it's not possible. Then how is it possible? How does a river know the ocean? By becoming the ocean. All this preparation has to be done by mind only. What preparation? Like suppose you want to go to sleep. How do you experience sleep? How do you know that you are sleeping? By sleeping. By sitting, can you know that you are sleeping? In a wakeful state, can you know you are sleeping? Only when you have merged your mind in sleep, that's when you are sleeping. But to merge your mind into sleep, what all you require? You have to finish the whole day's work and assignments, finish your food, then come to your bed, and bed should be spread, and then light should be switched off, and all noise should reduce. You should finish your night prayer, and then you go to bed, and then you go into sleep. For the sake of going to sleep, how many things you did? You finished the day's work, you finished your food, you came back to your room, you spread your bed, and then you are lying down on the bed, and then sleep comes. If you say, I want to get sleep, I want to get sleep, sleep will not come. If you just prepare yourself and lie down in the bed, you never know. Do you ever know? At 10.02.33, I went to sleep. Nobody knows when the sleep comes. You just lie down and you can't declare to yourself, at 9.00.00, I must be asleep. You can't dictate this to the sleep. You can't control sleep like this. So what you do, you prepare yourself to sleep and then you leave it there. After that, what happens? Once you have calmed down your mind, there are no more worries and thoughts and no more ideas and desires. The mind slowly goes and merges into sleep. So this is very practical. You experience it every day. If your mind keeps thinking, I must sleep, I must sleep, I must sleep, I must sleep, it will never sleep. Or if your mind is thinking, what did I do the whole day? I did not do this right, I did that wrong, and tomorrow I have to got to do this and day after that. If mind is so active, what will happen? It will never sleep. When mind becomes zero, then it automatically goes to sleep. So how do you achieve this through the mind, Brahman, this oneness? When mind merges in that Brahman, it means Yachet Jnana Atmani into Mahati Atmani and Mahati Atmani into Shantatmani. So every day when we go to sleep, we are the closest to our Shantatmani status. Not ordinary sleep, deep sleep, Sushupti. That is the time we have gone closest to the state of Shantatmani. That's why you're so peaceful. When we wake up from a deep sleep, the first thing what we say is, I had a very nice, deep, peaceful, restful sleep. Why it is happening? Because you allowed your mind to merge into sleep. You didn't keep it separate from the sleep. But through this mind only, you made all the preparations to go to sleep. Finished your studies, assignments, finished your food and prepared your bed, chanted your prayers and went to sleep. But when you were sleeping, the mind did not exist. Likewise, when you want to realize this oneness of everything, the Brahman in everything, your mind cannot exist separately from Brahman. It has to merge into that Brahman. That is the only time you experience this oneness. If you think you will sit here and experience the oneness of everything, not going to happen. It's like sitting here and saying, I must sleep, I must sleep. It's not going to happen. That is the idea of why mind alone. So that's why maneva manushyanam karanam bandha mokshayo, I say. Mind is the reason for one's liberation or bondage. Bondage when the mind thinks it's separate thing, it needs to control everything, it needs to do this and do that, bandha. And if it doesn't do anything, it just simply submits itself to the sleep, mokshaha. So when it submits itself to Brahman, mokshaha. And very beautifully in one of the Gaudapada Karikas of Mandukya Upanishad, which is about Jagrita, Svapna, Sushupti and Turiyavastha, Gaudapada Karika says this. He says, Atma Satyanu Bodhena Na Sankalpayate Yada. After having realizing what is the truth, when mind does not think anymore, it has stopped thinking, because mind's only job is think. Think good, think bad. Think nice things, think ugly things. Think holy things, think unholy things. Happy things, sad things. Mind is only meant to think. When mind stops thinking, na sankalpayate yada. Who? Mind. Why? Because it has understood the truth. Atma satyanu bodhena. Experience the truth. What happens? Amanastam tadayati. Amanastam is the state. It means it has no mind at all. Mind has disappeared. Like in sleep, your mind has disappeared. Like that in Brahma Satya, that realization, your mind just disappears. At that point in time, only you know the truth. Amanastam yatadayati. And what else he says? Grah abhave tat agrahat. Because there is nothing for it to catch hold of. In sleep, do you, deep sleep, where is anything existing to catch hold of? In deep sleep, where is the desires? Where are the thoughts which were there whole day? Where is the past and where is the future? Nothing exists in deep sleep. So that state is where you become one with everything. Same thing has to happen through your sadhana, where your mind becomes so pure, so calm. It has merged itself into the Shantatmani, so it is no more thinking. Because the moment mind thinks, it becomes Ishvara and the Jagat appears. The moment mind stops completely thinking and merges itself into the ultimate truth, it becomes Brahman. That's all it is. That is why mind is the key to liberation or bondage. When your mind becomes so pure. So when does your mind think? Ask yourself, when your mind thinks, when it identifies itself with the body, it starts thinking. When it doesn't identify itself with the body, the mind cannot think. When your mind identifies that you are this body with this name and form, immediately starts thinking, what about this body's future? What about this body's welfare? What about this body's likes and dislikes? What about this body's friends and enemies? What about this body's ambitions and dreams? Or what about the wrong that this body has done? What all the sins I have committed? What all? This is how mind keeps thinking. What does mind do? It thinks of the past or it thinks of the future. That's all is the mind's problem. It never stays in the present. All the time thinking behind or forward. But only when mind has been completely absorbed in the higher truth, like you get absorbed in the sleep, that's when you realize the problem. But in sleep, what is happening? Unfortunately, you are not aware of the truth. You are experiencing the truth, but you are not aware of the truth. Like our Tripura Rahasya, Dattatreya says, somebody has an emerald in his hand, a big gem, very precious gem, but doesn't know that it is an emerald. This is a story, one fellow who found a very precious stone in the forest while, you know, taking his goats for grazing, found a very beautiful shiny stone, and he thought he should tie it around the neck of its favorite goat. And he tied and was feeling so happy, I've tied this whole beautiful stone around my goat's neck. And when he was returning, somebody who was a jeweler, who knew what is the worth of that stone, he approached him and said, where did you find this? He said, I found it in the forest. Will you give it to me? No. Why? My goat looks very beautiful. As if the goat is bothered about the stone, for it is still a bondage only. So what does this fellow do? He doesn't want to give the stone. Then this fellow offers 10 rupees. He said, no. 100 rupees, no. 1000 rupees, no. 10,000 rupees. Then he thinks something is more, this stone's worth is more than 10,000. Then that is why he's wanting to buy. Because he knows if he buy for 10,000, he may sell it for a lakh of rupees. Otherwise, why? So he decides, then he goes to his friend and finds out that it is diamond. This is not a piece of stone. And then he realizes his worth and becomes very rich. Idea is that we don't realize the worth. That is why we keep running around like beggars. We don't realize our infinite worth. We are precious. Oh no, I'm a sinner, I'm useless, I'm dull, I have nobody to talk to me, I have no friends, I have no whatever. This whole negativity comes from this idea of wrong identification of who you are. Like the cub thinks it's a sheep, lion cub, and goes on bleating and fearing everything. The moment he realizes it, lions, it knows its worth, and then everything. Today, in modern psychology, they're using this word very strongly called self-worth, self-love. They're trying to teach this to the next generation. Please know your self-worth. Don't think of yourself any less because your nose is not as straight as the other girl's nose. And your teeth are parted, not like the other one who's perfectly set. And because of that, you don't have enough likes on Facebooks and Instagrams and followers on YouTube. Don't think you are any less. They have to teach this. Psychologists are teaching this to the younger generation. It's about self-worth. Love yourself as you are. Self-love, because people are getting into depression for wrong reasons. So here is Brahma Vidya, which says, you are Brahman. That's all you are. That is the most ultimate thing, the parakashtha, sagakashtha, saparangati. After that, there is nothing. That is what you truly are. Why should you give in to all these silly things and then suffer imaginary sufferings, imaginary illusions? That is how, if you don't realize this using your mind in this very birth, by training your mind, mastering your mind, and merging this mind at the end into the Brahman, it means there is no more thinking on your part. And you will almost say, how is that possible? We have to think. No. You will not be thinking. Mind will be thinking. You are not thinking. As if you are in autopilot, you are only a witness that Brahman will do everything for you. Which way to go, what to do, what to eat today, what to wear today, everything will be guided by that Brahman only. You will be simply witnessing, you will just move, how this river moves, along the terrain. The terrain decides. River does not decide. The terrain decides. How terrain decides, you tell me? First of all, river starts from the hill and goes down the slope, and by gravity only the water is moving towards the ocean. It's not some pump set has not been put to pull the water. Nor river is being forced. The mountain is not pushing the river, go towards the ocean. No. What is happening? There is a gravitational force by virtue of which river is moving. The terrain. Likewise, your life will move on its own towards the ocean, towards Brahman. You don't have to think and strategize and plan for your future and worry about how to get rid of your past. Don't have to do anything. Just be, just surrendered mind. And like the river, naturally by gravity flows through it. Neither there is an engine at the back nor there is an engine in the front. It just moves on its own, effortlessly. That is why I said ashrami, ati ashrami. Effortless life. We are surrendered to God. Whatever comes, if a big stone and boulder comes, what will happen? By very force of gravity, by the nature of the river, either it will overflow that or it will find a route and go. Like we went to Ganges. What happened? They have built one dam over there, some human intervention into the nature's flow. And then the Ganga has been diverted into a canal. Before, between Rishikesh and Haridwar. So in Rishikesh, Ganga is flowing without any problem. After that, they have put one dam at Rishikesh and they produce whatever electricity out of hydropower, and then they direct it into a canal because they want a very strong water. And then what happens? This canal is for irrigation and other purposes, and then finally it goes back and joins Ganga somewhere else. But even in canal, did Ganga stop flowing? It kept on flowing. If canal came, okay, no problem, I'll flow through the canal. I must keep flowing. That is all Ganga's problem is. She is not asking, no, why a canal? I'm not going to go to the canal. You put me back into the right path, I'll stop flowing, I'll disappear next moment. It can't. Like that, I don't want this food. I don't want this. I don't want that. All these problems are because nana eva pashyati. You're seeing differences outside. That's why this is I want, that I don't want. This is nice, that is not nice. All these is imaginations of mind. And therefore, the one who is surrendered, his life will flow like a river towards the ocean. How? By virtue of gravity. Neither the mountain has to push the river, nor the ocean has to pull the river. It will simply flow on its own. That is effortless life. That is ati ashramin.